We want to just talk about something tonight. I want to share about the state of the world for just a moment. And in doing that, we're going to share about the state of the church. Because the state of the world is partially that way because of the state of the church. We are in a revival. Not all parts have yet of the church have yet received or understood or taken part of this revival somehow. I grew up in the valley. I was born again. I knew Jesus. I went to a Presbyterian church. I received Christ really personally at a Billy Graham Crusade in San Diego. But there wasn't any place that I could find where there was really a true spirit of love, of worship, and of Christ. You have never come across a sadder individual in all your life than me. Because I had clothes, because I've been brought up right, because I had nice cars and money, maybe you couldn't tell it right off. And because of the fact that so many other people were worse off or bad off as I didn't stick out that much. But inside, I was so miserable. And I was so seeking God. But I couldn't find Him. Now, I didn't just go to the Presbyterian church or the Baptist church, and I went to almost every church, Methodist, Lutheran, Pentecostal. I was in the house of a pastor, a very well-known pastor, one of the largest churches in the valley, Pentecostal. But because of the fact I was so flashy and I was worked at Disney New Studios, I was in Hollywood, I was involved in all, they were scared out to death of me. Yet I was standing in their midst, my best friend was the associate pastor's son, backslidden of course, I didn't know the difference. I didn't even know there was a backsliding. I didn't know there was anything to backslide from, I thought everybody was as miserable as I was. And when I went around, when I searched, with that so many other people are searching, I did not find it in the churches, not in this area or in any other area, till I happened to run across a real wild group of people down at Calvary Chapel in Costa Mesa. How God worked upon Chuck Smith's heart to open his doors to the Jesus people, I'll never know. You never seen a more motley crew. They're all dressed up and shiny now. But the things that I have been involved with and the things, drugs, sex, Hollywood, jet set, money, doctors, lawyers, producers, directors, scientists, these were the people that I ran around with. Hollywood mansions, Beverly Hills, clubs, supper, after hours clubs, supper. There was no truth in any of it, and I knew it because I had Jesus. There are literally thousands and yet millions of people in this area and all kinds of other areas that are by the skin of their teeth saved. Somehow they touched God someplace a long time ago, but they never, ever, 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 ever had a real, real, full relationship with Him, and they're sort of mushing around, walking around, wandering around in the wilderness. They just barely crossed the Red Sea, and as a matter of fact, it was so soon before the ocean came back, and they were just sort of brought up on the tide as the sea broke and came again, and they just barely made it. They're just so barely saved. They don't even know what salvation is. They really don't even know what they're born again experience. They don't understand what happened to them. They really have made a commitment. But the thing that is so horribly wrong is it just that they can go on and 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 never really have an experience, a full, marvelous, a biblical experience. I'm not experience-oriented, except that I'm a life-oriented, the life of Christ. I wouldn't come out here if I didn't know Jesus was with us. How foolish. I can't heal anybody. I can't preach to anybody either. You're scared. You can see you from this angle. I don't know you. You don't know me. Aside from in the spirit. Now the indictment comes even heavier upon the Pentecostal believer. When I was that old mushy nobody, you know, I go witnessing. I used to go witnessing all the time in the world. We'd be sitting around with a pipe of hash, marijuana, something like, you know, Jesus can save you. You're going to have a life under Jesus. That's how you smoke marijuana. And I'd say, pass the joint, pass the marijuana cigarette. Don't you know Jesus? You don't believe in God? You don't believe in God? Are you crazy? Everybody believes in God. I've been saved, you know. They go, what's that? Well, I didn't look saved. I wasn't any different from them except the one little something, so small. You talk about the grace of God. You talk about the grace of God, beloved. He should have kicked me out the back door so long ago, but he didn't. He didn't. He let me go through hell on earth. If some of the Methodists are right and this is hell, then I went through that part of it. It's round of Zusa and by, oh, no. You'll get used to me in just a minute. I'd go to these big parties and I'd sit on these beautiful staircases in these gorgeous homes on a modern pad that had glass overlooking Hollywood Boulevard or the Sunset Strip, you know, and you'd sort of open the kitchen window and drop about 1,000 feet or it looked like that. Yeah, these beautiful, beautiful things where these great big parties were, singers and the people of Hollywood. And I'd sit on the steps and I'd talk to them about Jesus. With my cigarette, with my liquor, with my drugs, with my whatever else. And I talked to them about God. Because I knew that the only thing in the world was God. I didn't think he had anything to do with anybody. Why should he anyway? You see, I was trying to figure it out. And there was no one that was bringing me any other message. Sure, I studied the word. A little bit. Christmas and Easter. But you see, I was living with a Pentecostal kids, two of them, both of them not kids. At home we'd sit, you know, on an off night and they'd recite to me the Bible. I loved it. I loved God. I loved everything about God. I had this hunger, such a hunger you couldn't believe. A hunger that has not yet nor ever will until I see him face to face be completely satisfied. A hunger that borders on mania. You step in between me and my God and see if that happens. There was something always there, but the problem was nobody had ever insinuated in any way that Jesus was able to relate to people. The majority of the church today has no idea that God has any emotions or feelings or any way of relating or any thoughts or ideas or has any way of touching the human being and the human being understanding what he's saying. And if they do, it's so basic, it's so silly, it's so infantile, it's so faithless, really. When they're about ready to go off of a cliff, then they go, oh, Jesus, and he goes, hello there. Help me, and Jesus goes, fine, will you pay a little more attention to me? And it just passes them because they don't know that he even wants. And the Holy Spirit, what's that? Well, isn't that in the
praise God's name, holy, yeah, I remember hearing him someplace. Yeah. But yet it says in Acts, and you've heard sermons, a thousand of them, I bet you have. Some of you look like you're pillars in the church. Saved 112 years, he spoke in tongues 75. But let me tell you something. Most people don't have any idea about the Holy Spirit. Now, they're just hungry. They're literally starving. They're literally starving, 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 starving. And they go to these rocketdyes and Reeves and Douglas and lawyers and hairdressers and school and every place else. And they're starving to God. They're starving to God. And they're filling their lives with literally everything. Whatever they get into, they're getting into. Don't tell your kids because they smoke drugs. If this church isn't filled with the Holy Ghost, and if this church, I know it is because of the presence, it's so easy to minister here. But there's always a place where we can better ourselves. There's always more of the Lord. There's always more. We shouldn't be satisfied with what we think is the most. We're allowed to find out we have about the least. God's unsearchable riches have not even begun to be tapped. People need, want, desire the truth about God. That's why they're worshiping the devil. Two Saturdays ago, a girl that had been worshiping the devil came up and received Christ as her Lord and Savior. I laid hands on her and the power of God knocked her across the room, across the stage, just boom. They want Jesus, and it's not just the young people. Some of the hardest cases are the older people. So set in their ways, so convinced because of our lousy testimony that there's nothing involved. You saw the Presbyterian, you saw his wife. Beautiful silver hair. No spring chicken. But it takes reality to let you know. It takes truth. How can you dare say Jesus is coming and then live like he's never going to come back again? How can you dare say that Jesus is everything and then you're as covetous and as selfish as if you were a heathen? I'll tell you something about the people today. The world has educated, so educated, no better educated, and so heightened the senses of the young people that they are so sharp they notice things you never notice. They're looking to see how sincere you are. They look to see what you really think, how you really act, how I really act. The reason they're not so convinced of this great, marvelous Savior is they're not sure about the kind of salvation you believe in. That's why we just teach the very simple things. That's why we just try to bring people back to the very simple things. The very simple things, and that is, you're saved by grace. If you're saved by grace, then you don't have to worry, listen to me, you don't have to worry about your own righteous standing with God. As long as you're trying to be righteous in yourself, you're going to blow it every time. Every single time you're going to blow it. Now, you may not understand, so listen. Every time you try to be righteous within yourself, the people that are looking at you are going to see nothing but a self-righteous hypocrite. I say I have forgiveness of sins in Christ. Then why am I so guilty and laden with sin, depression, and condemnation? Why am I so worried all the time? Why am I so under bondage all the time, acting like God's going to kick me out of that door any moment? Because I don't believe what the Bible says or what I talk about. I believe in personal holiness, but the only way you can be personally holy is if you are crucified with Christ. How many people are crucified with Christ? All right. How many people are are raised again with Christ. There's the difference. Listen to me. God doesn't want you to be an old dead person. You're crucified. You have been crucified with Christ. You're correcting your old man dead, beloved. Dead. But not dead, but alive unto God. We forget that. But alive unto God. Four little words we forget about. You are to be alive unto God. If you're alive unto God, the Spirit of God and the Spirit of life that works in you will overcome the spirit of death and of sin. And will keep that old nature crucified. Read the sixth chapter of Romans. Simple, simple, simple. You have become a new creature in Christ. All things are literally passed away. You are no longer a human being in the realm that the rest of the people are. Did you ever think of it that way? You're a new creation. The other people are dead unto God. You have the Holy Spirit dwelling within you. You are a temple of the living God. You are a temple of the living God. That's so simple. It almost confuses you. So simple. You are changed, 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 changed. You are saved, you are saved, you are saved, you are saved, you are saved. The righteous standing is the righteous standing of Jesus Christ. You stand and you live in the righteousness and because of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. You have grace to walk and to live in this world, giving your whole mind, soul, body, and spirit, or seeking to give your whole mind, soul, body, and spirit to the love of God and to the love of neighbor. The reason that the church is not showing the love of God is because they do not understand their salvation. They do not understand that God has come and dwelt in their bodies. That when they asked Jesus Christ to forgive their sins, lo and behold, He did. God did because of His Son. God the Father forgave you because of Christ. And you are set free. He no longer imputes sin to you. Now let's not sin that grace may abound, shall we? There's enough grace abounding now. Beloved, if you really realized that you were forgiven of sin, you wouldn't sin. You wouldn't want to sin. You'll make mistakes, but you'll not habitually sin. What's one of the biggest sins that the church is engaged in? Not loving God, not loving their neighbor, hating themselves. They don't really, 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 really understand the love of God. So they don't really, really, really give themselves to God. So they don't really, 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 really even understand what loving the brethren or the brothers or the world is. They don't really understand that you've got everything. Everything you've ever wanted, everything you could ever want. That God's going to provide, He's going to take care of you, He's done everything, everything. If He died for you, if Christ died for you, if God gave you His Son, if the Holy Spirit is interceding for you, if the Holy Spirit is your comforter, what more do you want? What more could God do for you? Everything else is chicken feed. You're set free. You don't have to worry about your own righteousness. Because God has made you righteous in Christ. You don't have to worry about the power to live in this world because you're alive unto God and the Holy Spirit is dwelling in you. You don't have to worry about power because you have power in the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit has come upon you and He will give you power to become witnesses. Actually, the Greek word is martyrs, which means where we get our word martyr. You'll be able to lay your old life down. You'll be able to take up the new life. You'll be able to be crucified with Christ, nevertheless you live. Yet not I, but Christ lives within you. You'll be able to understand the ABCs of Christianity. A, B, C. The church is too blasted religious. And the world knows it. They're tired of hearing a bunch of jargon from us. They're tired of hearing a bunch of jargon and not seeing much. They're tired of being judged Because they know they're under judgment. They're looking for the reality of Christ, and they're looking for a God that's powerful. And the problem is, most Christians don't realize they have one. Most Christians don't realize that they are so secure in Christ, that they are so secure in Christ, that they can love other people. Love other people. That you can stretch forth your hand and so what if they kick you in the face, you can say, Jesus is the way. You can be so secure in Christ, so understanding that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. You can be so aware that you are a new creature in Christ, an ambassador of Christ. So aware that you are a child of God. That you have broken any links to express and to share and to bring people to Christ. You won't be involved in building a kingdom. You're except for the kingdom of Christ. Not your own kingdom, but the kingdom of Christ. You won't worry about how spiritual you are. You'll realize you're very spiritual in Christ. You won't worry about whether everybody else can tell how spiritual you are. Nothing is more hypocritical than somebody trying to act spiritual. There's no one more cold, more unkind, because the minute you tip their hand, they turn on you. So they have to defend their own place in God. And I was looking, and I was looking hard, and I couldn't find anybody that really believed in what the Bible said. Oh, they believed it for a little bit, but they didn't understand it. They hadn't delved into it. They hadn't let that word really change them. They hadn't got salvation that was salvation. I needed salvation. I needed a God that had salvation, that would really save me. I had so many sins bound up, if He wouldn't forgive them, Lord have mercy. You had to really have a lot of forgiveness to forgive my sins. And then you had to have unbelievable amounts of grace to get me walking, to get me crawling, even to drag me by my heels. I needed a God, the same God that's in this word. The same God that dealt so long with Israel, that's still dealing with Israel, and is going to bring the tribulation. The same God that loved us so much, that before the foundations of the earth, He says the Lamb was slain, His very Son. I needed a God that was a God, not just a glorified human ideal. Someone that had was so much like a man that he was any moment going to hit me with that giant fly swatter in heaven. I needed a God. I needed somebody that knew this God. Nobody really knew Him. I couldn't find anybody that knew Him. And as for power, everybody said, repent, repent, repent. And I go, I can't repent. I don't have the ability. Nobody ever told me that God would give you the strength. God would give you the power. God would draw you by His Spirit. I'd go, okay, I'll try. It was like a New Year's resolution. I'd keep turning over a new leaf. It was like I was on a rotisserie. And I was. And I was cooking. And every time I turned over a new leaf, I'd fail. But then I found somebody that told me that in receiving Jesus, I was a new creature in Christ. That old things are passed away. That I was to stay in this world, but I was not to be of it. And I thought, I don't know very many people that believe that. Most everybody is so hooked into this world system that they can't get out. Most churches talk about Jesus, but never really, really, really experienced Him. Because if they did, I know I would have found it. And so, you see, I gave myself to Jesus. And then I found out even more how few Christians, listen, really understood the ABCs of salvation. And the reason I found out was that it was so marvelous, so glorious, yet so simple, so absolute, that it was almost impossible for the complex minds and lives of to grasp that we would not take him simply and believe him for what he says. And I found that if I would give myself to the Lord and seek to give myself as fully as possibly I could at that moment, then the end would begin to see that miracles would begin to happen. Little miracles first, small miracles first. I began to experience something. I received this baptism of the Holy Spirit, and then I really began to experience something. And something I began to experience was the Word of God. I had been through all the funny shit. The moment I began to turn this way, this is because I was so into the world, so into the things of the world. The moment I began to get a little off center, I could tell immediately. I was so afraid. After those 4 years of backslidden Christianity, those 4 years of hell, I could taste it, I could smell it, I could see it. Just this lonely thing, just a degree off them, off center them, and I could tell. And the Spirit of God, I'd scream, I'd go, Lord Jesus, help me. And he'd get me right back on being. And I'd walk, 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 and I'd give up every single thing that the Lord ever, that I ever got in the world. I gave up everything. Money, a clothing store, everything. And a lot of bills too, believe me. All the way. Now, I don't necessarily want you to go out and sell everything. Sell it tonight. Sell out tonight. Really? You know the Bible. You know what it says. You know what he said. You know what he says. Start living it. That's all I'm trying to say. That's all I'm trying to say. If I can please you, then just forget everything I said. And just you know what the Bible says about your salvation. You know how you're saved. You know how you're kept. You know how soon he's coming. And you better know it. Because the devil knows it, let me tell you. And there's a world that wants to know Jesus, and they're not going to settle for a bunch of phonies or people that are just so barely hooked in, so barely given over to the Lord, so barely knowledgeable that they can hardly go, thank you, Jesus. Or the only time they can say it is in this church. You better be a better Christian outside of here than you are in here. In here, you should be repenting and seeking the Lord's forgiveness, washing, filling, changing, receiving from God outside. Live your holy life. Live your life unto the Lord. In this building, you come together to seek from Jesus, to seek from Jesus. No pretenses, no games, no funny business, nobody caring whether they're more spiritual or advancing more rapidly in the Word of God and in the spiritual things, but each one caring for one another. Then you take that outside. You take that outside and you'll shine like a morning star. You'll shine like a sun at noonday. You'll shine from... Oh, it's going to be interesting. What happens when one person in the church really turns on to God, really turns on to Jesus? One person! Watch out, everybody else. Watch out, everybody else, because... right through they go. while everybody else is sort of milling around. Let's bring everybody with us. I had a vision one time. And the Lord, I was just taken up into heaven. Remember, I hadn't been very long in the baptism and spiritual things. I was too stupid to resist. And all of a sudden, I've had the most unbelievable sensations. Joy, and I was so blessed. And I saw this huge, huge table of bread. And right in front of the bread were these people, and they were Christians. And they were just going like this. They were just, there were so many of them. And they were just going like this, like if you'd seen see pictures of starving people going for the bread, going for the bread. And I thought, well, why don't they eat? It's right there. The whole table's filled. Why don't they eat? And Jesus said, because they need someone to show them, to give them that bread. He said, you give it to them. And I go, Lord, they're ministers. They were ministers. I saw some of the people. And I said, if they don't see that it's bread, how am I supposed to tell them? They won't believe me. He said, you want to make a bet? He says, as soon as they smell it, they're so hungry, Brant. Remember how hungry you are for me. Remember how hungry you've been. You show them that bread of life. You show them that it's a narrow way. That it's a narrow way. And then you show them that there are millions and millions and millions of people that are literally starving to death. Starving to death for what you have, Brant, and what you know, and what you can offer them, or show them, or point out to them. There are literally millions of my people that miss first base. And they're coming around a third, and they don't know, and they don't know they've missed first base. And they're going to need to be understanding in every single one of the ABC. When you really begin to understand that you're saved, that you're the temple of the living God, that you're born again, baptized in the Holy Spirit, Christian. When you really begin to just listen to me, understand that, the whole world's going to know about it, it's going to happen so fast, and then you're going to be born, and they're going to go, what was that? You don't have long. We have been so wasteful with what we've had. We've been so selfish, so fearful, so shamefully gluttonous of the Holy Ghost. We come in and go, and we go outside and try to hold it till next Sunday or Wednesday, Tuesday morning prayer meeting. And some of the men don't get to go to Tuesday morning prayer meeting, women. You are the temple of the living God. You are not your own. You are not your own. You are no more your own than I am my own. It is none of my business to interfere with the workings of the Holy Spirit. God must take this vessel and express His own desires through it. Never will contradict this word. Never will contradict this word. But it will be completely involved, totally involved in sharing in word or testimony or witness. Some way it will be expressing the nature of Christ. Because the Spirit of God will draw through you people to Christ, and Christ will reveal the Father. You have it. You have everything you need. You don't need more. You have it. If you just stop being a bunch of constipated Christians. You have it. I'm here to tell you, I would have wanted, you know, I love Pentecostal ladies. But they scare me half to death. Oh, some of you know what I mean. I wish I had found somebody. I wish, oh listen, I wish. I have found somebody earlier. You don't know how many days, how many times, how many hours I pray to this God that I really don't know or understand. You don't know how I took drugs because why not? I took pills because why not? I'd have to go to those orgies and the artists and models balls and all those things. Why not? Who cares? Do you realize what the world is like? Do you realize what darkness is upon the face of the earth? Do you realize it? Do you realize it? Some of you live in it. Some of you will go out of here and you'll go into these places of the darkness. Well, don't you just cover your life. Don't just be a fearful thing trying to keep within yourself everything you've got until you can get back to church and get recharged. Take that energy with you. Or realize you are taking the energy, the power, the dominion, and the might, the Holy Ghost with you. You are taking Him with you. But make sure that He's really the one that's taking you with Him. Share what you've got. But make sure you know what you've got. Take a second look. Take a second thought. Take a moment and understand how many people have Jesus Christ running in their heart. I want every hand to have Jesus Christ running in their heart up. God have mercy upon us. Do you realize what you just said? You don't have the angel Gabriel. You don't have the angel Gabriel. You have God dwelling in your heart. You have the Almighty God dwelling in your heart. Nothing left. Not a cherub, not a seraphim. You have God dwelling in your heart. Why then is the world so hungry for God when there's enough of you here tonight to proclaim the gospel unto every creature on the earth? Why then isn't success one great big thing? You're the minister of the revival. You're the minister of the revival. As soon as you believe that you revive. You go, Brant Baker, how in the world could you, that's my name, how in the world could you say that to me? How do you know? This church seems to be a lot better off than most, and that's God bless you to be a pastor. And I'm very critical, very critical. But see, I hate that icky, carnal Christianity. That super righteous Christianity. I hate it with everything that's in me. It kept me from God for so long, so very long. But because of the fact that the whole world would have heard about this church, and it should, at least the whole world around here, should know there's God at this place. Every place Jesus was, there was a group of people that could not be accommodated, such as you have tonight. But it should be more and more and more, and I'll tell you it's going to be, I'll tell you it's going to be. The moment you wake up and realize what you've got, the Holy Spirit's going to say, well, honey, why haven't you been sharing it? You're going to say, oh, Jesus, forgive me. And you're going to be so bold, so vigorous, so filled to overflowing that everybody around is going to get wet. Hallelujah. That's the truth. That's the truth. It's coming. It's coming. Why hold it back? Why hold it back? Why hold it back? There's too many of you running around out there. Old and young, fat and skinny and stoned and not stoned, even possessed even some of them. Not if you're Christian, but don't let anybody give you a line. That's another thing. I'm going to say that for 5 seconds. The reason that this garbage, this full-on satanic, abuso belly garbage, has come into the church about Christians being demon possessed is Christians are so blasted stupid that they don't realize any BC. That's the reason. And you'll take anything on the land.
your soul will so ignorant of our born again experience. And the Bible says your body is the temple of the living God. That means your flesh and your soul. It's not talking about a secret compartment labeled eight for Holy Ghost. It says your body, and the Greek is very emphatic. And demonized means to be manipulated by a demon beyond your control. God is dwelling in, how many people are born again? Would you raise your hands? Again, I want everybody up. Then God have mercy upon the ignorance of humanity to think that the devil could manipulate a human being beyond his control that is possessed of the Holy Ghost. If you knew your God, if you knew your salvation, if you knew the Holy Spirit that is your comforter and that is the one that came over the waters, over the void spaces of the earth, the vessel that was created, the instrument, the part of the Godhead that created everything, the one who's going to rip you out of this world, honey, that's not going to be you're not going to be able to control that. But you've got God dwelling in your soul. You have the Holy Spirit dwelling in your body. And your body, every single stinking little piece of flesh, is the temple of the living God. You can't fight it. You go ahead. You can't fight the Bible. You go ahead and believe your demons are there. Then you go find out how many demons got built up. They didn't come coughing out either. And there's no such thing as a lukewarm demon-possessed person. The reason you think that there's prophetic demons is because of the fact that you are, yes, Pentecostal, but you don't know the difference. You don't understand the fullness of God, so you think the devil is as dumb as you. And the devil only partially possesses. The devil only is certain, as strong in a certain area. When you're possessed of the devil, honey, you're possessed of the devil. You may be honest, but you're not possessed of the devil. You may be vain glory, but you're not possessed of the devil. You're crazy. If you are if you realize the spiritual truth of being born again, and the total, total aspect of salvation, and the power that dwells within your body, and the grace that will grace over the stupidity of this doctrine of demonization or demon possession of Christians. That takes a lot of grace, because you're taking God and you're slapping Him right in the face and saying, you're not strong enough. You don't really have control of it. I have rooted out part of me to the devil. You can't find it in the Bible. It's not to do with the Bible, and it's a bunch of garbage. It's a bunch of them. How many people know what that is? To help you, it's manure. It just gets so worse. The reason the Christians are being so ripped off into false doctrine is this. Listen, they don't understand. A, B, C. The border again. The spirit today. The temple of the God. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation to which you are called. Paul says that he beseeches, he begs. All right, he is begging. Some people go, Brant, he's a strong officer. You're right, I do. It's a word that is to beseech, to beg, to plead. Paul is pleading to the church. He's pleading to the church here tonight. He's pleading not in the flesh or in carnal zeal. He's pleading in
them the anointing and the anointing and to be pleasing to God. It is pleasing. It's God pleasing to you and I. It's something that, literally pleased with us. Beautiful hunger to have somebody bathe in it. To have somebody really bathe in it. Have you ever had anybody fall at your feet and just bathe you, just bathe you, come to you and bathe you? Because of the fact that they were so interested. You've had a father or a mother plead with you for something. Plead with you for something they knew was for your good. Plead with you where they wouldn't just sort of cast you off and say, all right, that's okay if you don't want to do it my way, just get out. But they would really come and you'd have that intimacy. Have you ever had the occasion? And I don't think that very many of us have because we don't allow ourselves to get involved with people. We don't allow ourselves to get our necks stuck out so far that it can get chopped off. But if you ever have had that occasion where you literally had to because of the love of God or the love of even the flesh, even the phileo, any time in your life where you literally had to bathe, you just decided you knew so desperately that something was so desperately important that you were willing to cast aside, put away your earthly, human kind of pride. And this apostle, who was in prison at this time, he was sort of knocked down to the base thing, came there, and he says, oh, please. I beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation to which you are called. That vocation, the sons, the daughters, the children of God Almighty, the temples of the Holy Ghost. Listen to me. The temples of the Holy Ghost. If I ever do anything, if God raptures us, or if I die before he comes, I don't believe it for 1 minute. Let's speak hard when he's here. But, no! If you can understand that we are the children of God, you can understand that we are the children of God. There is such responsibility. There is such blessing and bliss in that responsibility. There's such glory. There's such things that I cannot put into words to know that we are the children of Almighty God. Oh, there's a pride. There's a pride, but it's a humble pride, if you know what I mean. It's that, I'm a child of God. It's that when you just became a Christian. It's that when you just received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's that when you just were touched by the healing power of God. When you were the same from backsliding and this or that. When you know that you, yes, I am the Son of God. I am the child of God. I am a child saved by grace. I'm adopted. I'm a royal priesthood. I'm part of that royal priesthood. I'm a king in that glorious kingdom. It's so beautiful. It's so wonderful. It's so fantastic. He says, oh, I pray. Won't you walk worthy of that vocation? Walk worthy of that vocation. And the only way to walk worthy of that vocation because you're faithful. If you're faithful, you're going to blow it. We know how to blow it. We know how to fake it. We know how to be hypocrites, actors. We know that very well. But the only way you can walk worthy of that vocation is to walk in the Spirit of God. To walk in the Spirit. To seek after those spiritual things. To desire them more than the things of the flesh. More than the things of ease. Very shortly, very soon, and I don't know where I'm waiting on the Lord, we will bring you that message of the temptation to take a sedative rather than a sedative of all sorts of different things, rather than really suffer the cross and how that such an automatic reaction, vinegar and gall mixed together, and that we try to drink it so that maybe some of the pain, some earthly pain, some fleshly thing, some desire to sort of ease the pain of what God desires, the beloved. We cannot say we can do that as God desires. We cannot say that we're walking worthy of that calling. Paul says it's possible. He says it's possible by merely being God's conscious. That sounds been a little warped lately. But being really concerned with Him, having the mind of God, being thinking of Him, not giving ourselves excuses why we aren't walking worthy. Why we aren't walking worthy of that vocation. Why people aren't able to see. while we are radiating the beautiful power of God, we're going to be looking right now. We're going to be looking right now at goodness with all meekness, with all long-suffering. Long-suffering. Beloved, long-suffering is the most wonderful, the most glorious thing I could even tell you about. It's one of the benefits of being a child of God. Long-suffering is keep you going, keep you going. I have stepped to this pulpit so many times,
the moment he wants. Long suffering for the coming of Jesus Christ. I'll tell you a secret. The reason that you're so downcast, the reason that the revival is so slumped, is because we have not been long suffering. Don't you know the only reason that the scripture sees us that Jesus Christ will wait is because he is desirous of the full harvest, the full fruit of the harvest, and every day that he waits, every moment that he has, it's a further indication that there is more to be done, there are more souls to be saved, there are more baptized Christians to come to the Lord, there are more people to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, there are thousands and millions in this area, in this case, in the world, hundreds of millions of people that are needy. If Jesus Christ comes today, there will be so many hundreds of millions of people left behind to go through the greatest tribulation that has ever come upon this world, this earth, the greatest sin, the greatest race of this world and of man and of men and of their minds and of their souls, the greatest race that shall ever come upon the earth. We have a reason for being here. We have a reason for being here. There's a need for us to be long-suffering, not just in the things of our brothers or sisters or our mother or father, but a long-suffering in the things that God wants, that God desires. So then, what if he teaches here? So what if he says, go a little longer? We cannot turn to the things of the world or to anything else to ease that time. We can only turn to him to be our sufficiency, to be the balm of Gilead, the healing balm, the life-giving water, the river of life flowing out from the innermost parts of our being. We become a little parched, and we turn to the right and to the left to hew out the cisterns that yet are broken. They cannot hold water. Things in rocks like the Indians used to do to hold water, and yet they dry up, yet they go out, and we're sort of slumped. Be long suffering with God, be long suffering with God, be long suffering with God. Because the fact that maybe you're going through a time that you have to have a little more faith, that you have to go through a time where you're having a little more confidence in him. Don't let up. That's just an indication that there's more to be done. Then you should take a deep breath of the Spirit and say, all right, then more shall be done. Then more shall be done. If you choose to tell him that another day, then that is an indication there is another day's work to be done. There is another obligation to be met. There is a responsibility I have as a child of God that I must walk worthy of. There is someone that needs the touch of God. There is someone that needs the touch of the Spirit. There is someone that is dependent upon the church of God. We are in this world yet one more day. We are in this planet and on this planet yet one more hour. And there is a need, there is a responsibility. There is a need for us to be long-suffering and stay as long as he wants. I wanted to come as much as any of us. May
maybe a little more. That's why I'm sharing this. As we begin to come into the things of the Spirit, as we begin to allow God, as we begin to walk worthy of the things, don't you think that more shall be done? Much more needs to be done. Unbelievable mountains need to be done. Mountains need to be moved. But where's the faith? Where's the mustard seed grain of faith? How easy it is to say that I'm just abiding when we're not truly abiding, when we're just lazy and lethargic and we're just having sort of an easy time of it. But every moment that we're left upon this earth, there is something more to be done. There is a greater responsibility every day, especially if every second ticks away, every second ticks away. The job, the work becomes greater and greater and greater and greater and greater for the time whenever we begin to really reckon that God has us to think that He has a will, He has a plan for this day, and if we are born again, He has planned for you to be born again and you to live in these very last moments. He has planned that from the beginning of time. It's no mistake that you're here. It's no surprise to God that you're here tonight. He knew you were going to be here tonight. He knew that you were going to be here tonight. He knew that you were going to be here tonight. He knew that I'd be telling you, that you'd be telling us that we are here for a reason, for a specific purpose, and that there is a need for us to be long-suffering because He's waiting for the full harvest, the full return of harvest. And what are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? We are the utensils, the vessels that are to be used to share. We are the light of the world, the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. That's the facility. You are the light of the world. You are to be beaming out this light. The light is to come flowing from you, the light of God flowing from you, showing the way to God, revealing Him, unveiling Him, and the blessing and the power and the goodness and the glory of God. You are the light of the world. Jesus said that He was the light of the world. And when He left this world to be with the Father, and He sent His Holy Spirit down upon us, He said to His disciples, He said to the church, you are the light of the world. We are the light of the world. There is a walking worthy. There is a responsibility that is not a work set. That is not a work that this Bible teaches laboring in the Lord. This Bible teaches faith without works is a bunch of garbage. It's just as dead as a doornail. It's just as dead as a doornail. Don't tell me, beloved, and I'll going to tell you this, that you're following Jesus, and it says no fruit of it. Jesus Christ is a very abundant God, according to the riches of His own, wouldn't be blessed. That's His desire. If our blessings are less than that, I'm talking about spiritual things, I'm talking about beautiful fruit coming from our lives, then it just proves that we are in a great need of being closer to Him. God doesn't make inferior trees. If a tree has bad fruit, it's because the tree is being planted and has been planted in bad soil. You are planted in God's vineyard, in God's garden, in God's soil, in Jesus Christ. And if you are not, or if you are in some way diseased, and that nourishment can't come through, you are the branches upon the vine. The vine is Christ. The branches are the church. If you... or someone has twisted you and twisted you and twisted you. Certain circumstances, twisted. I don't know, I've been pretty twisted myself sometimes. But beloved, it doesn't matter. If there has been anything that is successfully stopped that Holy Spirit, that light, that visible Holy Spirit, that power of God to bring out and come through your life as a friend, as a vessel, and then because of that, the fruit has stopped, the fruit is null and void, or it's just pitiful. The world sees the church and they see fruit. The fruit that they see is very pitiful. You are my fault. Not somebody else's fault, you're my fault. It's our fault. We're the church. We have the Bible. We have these things. The Spirit of God that sees us. We're just studying for so little. slither around here on my face. Does it do any good? Would it do any good? If it would, I would. I don't care. I literally don't care. If it would, I would. Time for those church to walk worthy, to begin acting like the church, to begin allowing the church, the power of God, to fulfill the church, to receive the responsibility, the blessedness of that responsibility. The purpose for us being here is God's almighty will and glory. He has something for us here. Why would he leave us here? What blessing is there in the world today outside of Jesus Christ? Why would he leave us here? Why would he leave us here to be parched and to be paying all sorts of exorbitant prices to General Mills and these different people and the meats and the groceries and the clothing and all these other things and taxes, and yet everything goes higher and higher and higher still? Why would he leave us in a place where wickedness is so prevalent, where television is become the game in every home? And why, beloved? Why would he leave us here when he desired our life to be in his life, the union to be so complete that he came and died for us? Why did he cause this separation? Why did he cause any part of separation from us? Oh, he is within you. He is with you. He is a part of you. You are one with Christ. But there is that old nature. There is that fortress that you walk around in. There is that earthly tabernacle. That earthly tabernacle causes the fellowship to be a little bit tainted, sometimes, you know, your mind can get carried away. You can go a little this way, you can go a little that way. It's not as pure and as wonderful as it would be if you were in heaven. Why would you suffer us to be here if it wasn't such a great plan? For he died and he loved us and he's left us here for some reason. What is the reason? It's for soul. It's for this offering. Let me tell you some listen to you. The truth doesn't mean, well, it does, there will be a revival. But before that, the church must have a reformation. A reformation. A real reforming. For the Jesus people, to the Catholics, to the Episcopalians, to the Presbyterians, all of us. A real reformation. I saw great revivals come. I've seen them come. And they sort of because the church is not able to handle a continuous revival at this time. Yet if there's anything that they need, the world needs, is a revival, a continual glory, a fantastic, beyond anything we've ever heard or seen, in this time for souls to be saved. And the reformation must come on, come about in the church. Judgment, God says, starts at the house of God. If you are born again, you are the house of God. And he says it starts right here, right in this building. The church isn't necessarily meant for evangelism. Did you know that? It's meant for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. We're going to see that in a minute. The church is this type of service, the most different. But your Sunday morning services, your weekly Bible studies are meant for your perfection or maturing, for your completeness, for your stability in the things of God. And this is what this world needs, is a church that's breathing healthy rather than asthmatic and suffering with all sorts of maladies and diseases and needs. We want God to spring. But right after the burst of spring, it's the infant. Again, you find it again, something. But the hallelujah is God down. You pray soft and it's down. And then I'm saved. I am saved. Me, that maker, I am saved. Woo! I'm saved. Along with the nation, there is something I am. When we forget how beautiful. He says, walk worthy. endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit, not allowing the divisions and backbiting and ill sectarian, but loving one another with a fervent love and the bond of the Spirit of the unity of the Spirit of the bond of peace, bond of peace, bond of peacefulness. This church will not be able to do anything as long as there's divisions or separations and backbiting and high and haughty and arrogant. Listen, you guys. I want everybody to surrender 25 or raise their hand. Come on, get them up. Let me tell you something about our smart aleck now. All right? I know about us. We are a bunch of smart now. Big smart now, the best people in town. Presidents and candidates and everybody else. We are smart now. We've been taught by the lack of correction to be that way. Not at all. You know that one of the most unbelievable things that the Old Testament is taught about is to say anything about God's anointing or elect. To talk about another Christian is a most blasphemous thing that's considered the same as murder. It disgusts God. Next time you start backbiting somebody, you'll stop when you realize that God has been abomination. He puts it in the same line as homosexuals, as racists, as murderers, liars, and backbiters, and murmurs, and scandals. Bible teachers that we are dependent upon one another. I am dependent upon you. I despise that idea that people sometimes get that I am hard to talk to because I am not hard to talk to. I have talked for hours with people I have never met before. We need each other. I need your ministry. I need your love so desperately as second only to the love of God. For I must love Him first, I need His love most. Then I must love you second, and I need your love second most. And that's the way it is. I need that fellowship. I need that. I need that. I need that. I need that. This body of Christ, the beautiful thing that Jesus Christ that is still known to disciples, not by your great powerful churches, not by your belongings, not by your savings accounts, not by your television shows, or not by your sister, not the groups or fires or whatever. They will know your disciples by His love. And when two people get together, when a couple people get together, Jesus Christ is in the midst of them. When they begin to minister, they begin to function, they begin to move in the Spirit of God, then the world knows that Jesus Christ is alive. But when we're all divisive and we're lazy and lethargic and fearful of stepping out, and when we think that there is some reason why we don't have any responsibility, why we are needed, well, I'll tell you, you're needed. You are needed. You are needed more than I can even put into words. There is a great need beyond all comprehension. I can't tell you anything else. This entire ministry has been given over to the ministering of the Word of God because of the fact that we know that the world needs a church that knows the Word and that is founded upon the Word and that is functioning in the power and the might of not flesh, not mind, but the Almighty power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it is just to see that. Get to see that in this last day. There's a most fantastic, glorious place. And no one can take your place. There's somebody trying fruitlessly to take your place. Someone is trying to carry your load because of the fact that they've given themselves to Jesus Christ. And because of the fact there has been such a great load given to each person that will truly take that responsibility, that some people have great responsibility that they were never even intended to have. Because so many others have convinced themselves that any longer, or they have a word, oh, I'm just a simple housewife. You probably are, but that isn't necessarily God's only will. Mm-hmm. that it may increase while your life is used of God. So we don't think that can use the blood of my children in God's grace on the part of it. Of course, the ART, apart from what you can do in your own flesh, apart from what you need to do to God to do also, but apart from the beloved, I'm studying. I hope you're going to be able to use all the instruments. God bless you, sweet soul, and the heavenly ministry classes.
I'm not against education, I'm not against anything. I'm against excuses. Excuses. Lousy, liver-lilling excuses. People don't like my shirt. I don't care. I don't like your excuses. I don't make excuses. I don't like your shirt either. Being hard on myself, just thinking the truth. Sometimes the truth is really wanting. I know that I have no right to give an excuse to God. I must seek His will, know His will in my life, seek that first, and then if God wants me to go to chemistry class or be only a housewife, then it won't be only a housewife. It won't be only on it. You'll be a spiritual minister of God in the house.
But that's not the case, usually. Not the case, usually, young men, young women.
Why don't you go to drama class? You've got a responsibility to God. You've been born with a fight. If I slack my rich wrist and I pour the sleep and you watch my life drain out of me, you would be absolutely appalled as my body began to change color from the lack of blood.
He has bought us each with His blood. You have never seen a more grotesque thing in all your life. How many people saw the Exorcist? Raise your hand, be honest. That girl in the Exorcist didn't look as bad as Jesus Christ did on the cross. That'll help you. He was so beaten that he didn't even resemble a human being. He was so put upon, so beaten, that he didn't even resemble a human being anymore. The visage, the right. We don't have the right. And this business about not being God's perfect will, that it's okay.
Garbage! When does it say in the scriptures it's okay for God's secondary, third, fourth, fifth, God's perfect will? He wants the best for you.
It's our lack of faith that causes us to desire the secondary things of God. Well, I'll tell you, I don't know whether I could be saved in this church or in other ones around. When I went to Calvary Chapel, I'll tell you what I found. I found love, I found Jesus. Not the same at all today here, or when I was there, it was so different from the things now. Oh, they were dirty, runty hippies. I wasn't, I was in fact very well dressed over Mercedes-Benz, but I didn't care. I loved Jesus. They loved Jesus. They loved me. Nobody used to mind all my clothes. When I had the men's store and used to give all those clothes away, thousands of dollars of them, nobody used to mind the fact that I had money when I used to have it and I used to give it away. Nobody used to mind that.
I'll tell you something. You might like to find 100 reasons why you should agree with this teaching tonight, but you won't be able to find any. I think that oftentimes, and I think that one of the biggest problems in the church today is the misuse and misunderstanding of God's grace. I can't completely explain that tonight. I love and I appreciate and I know what the grace of God is. I'm sure as much as anyone in this room, you can't minister like this without knowing it. You can't be as frail and as vulgar as I am without knowing the grace of God and the love of God and the teaching power of God. But I don't have one excuse. I wouldn't dare give one excuse to things that scares me more than anything else. I'll tell you the truth. It's an excuse. An excuse. I don't want an excuse because an excuse will separate me from what God wants. I want His will for you more than anything in the whole world. I want His will for you more than anything in the whole world. That is why I have personally, I have ministered to you. I want you to be honest again, and I want you to raise your hand. Those of you that have ever backbitten me in this room, raise your hands. Come on, choir, get them up too. That's what. Come on. There's more of you. I know that. And I love you. I love you. I know that I minister to the people that sometimes have done the most harm, the most unkind things, have said the most crushing things, and I hear about them too. You do anything, and I will do anything. I'm standing here proof that nothing is too hard for God. And he'll use anybody that will just give him an excuse. I won't give him an excuse. They will give him an excuse to use them. I stand here absolute proof of that. Proof. No, I'm glad that your mind boggles. You go, why does he use him? Because I have yielded to him. That's the only thing. That's my whole life desire is yield and not resist. And be honest. Honest. People want me to come out and be just like everybody else. I will suffer with faith in you. God says to put a suit and tie on. I won't put it on. I will suffer reproach because there must be some lesson in it for all of us. Because it would be so easy to be just like everybody else. But maybe it's because of the fact he wants to shock us. Maybe it's because of the fact he wants to say, we've got to love, we've got to get it together, we've got to have fellowship with one another. Not outside the Word of God, not outside the things of God. And there's very few preachers that I know of in this area that are standing up as skillfully as I preach to preach the unmitigated Word of God, despite whether these services decline, despite whether the money stops coming in, I don't care. The thing that God has called me to do is not necessarily to just pray for people and have miracles happen. It's to preach the Word. I have been called to minister the Word of God, to share the Word of God. That is my first calling. The things that happen afterwards are the result and the confirmation of that Word. I would do anything. I still will do anything. For you to see how needed you are, how desperately important you are, how precious you are to God, how much He loves you. See, sometimes, you know, we're hurting ourselves because we're not loving one another, because we're so starving for love ourselves. I can't stand it. Sometimes I just can't stand it when I see a Christian. It's having a hard time because they're just suffering for love. I go, Lord Jesus, please let me love them, please. God, help somebody, please. Lord, there's so much love. They don't feel important. They don't feel anybody cares. It kills me. And I've been shared and I've gone and I've tried to do things and strange things. Been up all night staring and talking and trying to say, I love you and God loves you. Oh,
Oh, don't you know how much God loves you? Each of us should be doing this. Each of us has this responsibility. This place, people need you, and they need to be needed, and you need to be needed, and you are needed. And don't think of it too high above you. Walk worthy of the vocation to which you're called. There is a place, and that place has, of course, the love of God is what's going to constrain you. This is what's going to be doing it, but give him the chance. Give him the chance. Don't settle for anything less. Don't become a third cousin to God. Oh, please, he loves you. There's such a need. I need you. Others need you. And the Word of God says that we're to be a beautiful family, a beautiful body of Christ, a beautiful moving of the Holy Spirit. He says, listen to this. There's not all these different sections and sects and all. He says, there's one body, one Spirit, even if you're called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. That baptism is a baptism into the body of Christ. It's not the baptism in water, and it's not the baptism in the Holy Ghost. It's that baptismal into the body of Christ. When you are born again, you are baptized. You are completely submerged or completely identified with Christ. You become one with Him. That is what it means. The baptism in water is the outward sign of what has happened inward, and it's not talking about anything other than you are baptized into Christ. You become one with Christ. And listen a little farther. He says there's one God and one Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. And he says that unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. You have grace, unmerited favor, so that you can step out, so that you can be a part, so that you cannot enter in because you're so desperately needed. He's using those people that have no ability to do things without his power. He knows it, and because of that, he knows you're going to fumble at sometimes. You're going to stumble, you're going to have a difficult time, so he gives you unmerited favor, he gives you grace to go by. Wherefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive. Those that have been captive have been set free. He gave gifts to men. He gave gifts to men, and more accurately, I believe, in the Greek it says he gave gifted men to the church. He gave gifted men, gifted women. There is a need. You have these things and these gifts that are so needed. People on the outside need them. People on the inside need them. He said he that ascended is the same also that ascended, is the same also that ascended far above all heaven, that he might fill all things. He filled you. And listen to this. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. But why do you give these things? Why do you have these gifts? You have them for the perfecting or the maturing of the saints. This ministry, the ministry is to minister to you, to perfect you, to mature you, actually, to complete you, to where you're standing on that solid rock, where you're stable, where you're able to be used of God for the ministry of the, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the work of the ministry, the gift and church and all these things, church, these church meetings, unless they're evangelistic meetings, are for the perfecting of you, for working on you, the getting you together, not so that you can tithe more. But that's part of it, I guess. I don't know. Won't rule it out. I don't know. But for the perfecting of the things, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into unity of faith, to the unity of Christ as our Savior, and the knowledge of the Son of God, unto the perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. What does that mean? What does that mean? It means till we all come into the unity of the faith, till we're believing and trusting and praying for Christ. All the backsliders come home. All those people that God has chosen come together. All those people that are to be saved are saved. And the knowledge of the Son of God, where we come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, everyone that is going to be, you come to that knowledge, to a perfect man. The Greek word again is complete. The Greek word does not mean perfect any more than blue in Greek means yellow. It was mistranslated. It's a bad thing. The word has lost its meaning, changed its meaning over the years from the translation. It means complete or mature, stable, to a complete man. There is a man upon this earth,
beloved, Jesus Christ knows there is a body of Christ, rather, upon this earth, the body of Christ. Jesus knows every single person that will be caught up in the great rapture. Jesus knows every single person that is going to be saved in the great catching up. Jesus knows everyone that's going to be left behind. There is a complete plan, a complete church. There is a number that has got to be saved. This is the full harvest. This is the complete harvest that God is waiting for. You and I are ministers to minister so that we can minister, so that the body of Christ can be complete, so that he can take us up someplace in the world. Sometimes there's a person, and that person, the very last person, will raise his hand at an altar call to stand up at an altar call. It may be here tonight. Watch out. But I doubt it. Because I see the unbelievable need that he could be here. He could be here. He could be here. Till we come, beloved, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Christ died for the salvation of the world. I know that this ministry is of God. You know how? Not because of the miracle. Not because of the miracle. Because I know a lot of false teachers as miracles. I know it's a miracle and it's of God because tonight there are at least 200 or more people ministering. There are about 70 or more people ministering. And this is the gift. Now this is amazing. It's the very same gift. Catherine Coleman has, who's probably the most famous woman evangelist in the world today, the gift of knowledge and the gift of healing. We have as many people in this ministry, 400 or some, that are ministering. They'll be ministering in Andrew's temple. Most churches don't have that many people in their churches. And this is just the ministry team. The reason I know this ministry is of God is because of the fact the hundreds of people, or 100 people, there's more than that though, say 100, it's 200 people, working at the same time, in the same service, directed by the Holy Spirit, working without fear of jealousy or fear, working because the Spirit of God is guiding them. If I go to heaven tonight, I will know that this ministry has been of God because the fruit has been undeniable. As we go up north and went up north, the minister of that church who is on the council of the Assembly of God, he is on the council. He has 400 churches under him. And he was amazed. It's a body ministry because you don't see that. It's because I haven't tried to make myself king or beaten or anything else. I'm not interested in that. I would give anything in the world to let you know that you are the important one. You are the one that God is seeking to use beyond your wildest imagination. God needs you. I need you. You. You need me too. Bless your sweetheart. That's true. I wish you could feel what I'm feeling right now. There's the most unbelievable pull for healing. I'm not the healer, but you feel this, you know. Maybe because of the stuff I've gone through in my life. It's what I've gone through in my life.
not afraid to love you, and so you write to your old ugly face that I love you. I just love you. I know God. You feel this pain, you feel this cold, you're so frustrated. Because you know that that pole is too strong for you, the one person. It means the 100 or 70 or so people that will be ministering in the gift of healing, the word of knowledge. These people that minister are told time after time after time after time. You can ask Linda, you can ask Diane, you can ask these different people. They're told, I've told them, I need you to be ministering. I can't do it without you. I can't do it without you, Joe. I can't do it without you, Steve. I can't do it without you, Randy. Can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. That's why they have a liberty that other ministers and ministries don't have any idea of. These people have a ministry and a liberty to be led of the Spirit of God because the pole. I can barely stand it. That's the only thing I can do anymore. That's the only thing I do anymore, hardly, is the ministering in these services. The pole is unbelievable. And yet still, though there's so little done other than waiting on the Lord in the Word and the responsibility to give your own other people for the things, there's still, it's impossible. There's still, the power is so much, it's impossible. And no matter how many services, no matter how many miles you go, still the power is more and more and more and more and more. Beyond comprehension, enough for each of you to be feeling exactly the same thing. And then each congregation and each group and each person you meet to come into the same place and to feel that again and over and over, it still would be pulling and seem to grow and grow. And as it goes larger and larger, the pool is more and more and more. That's why Jesus was 50 when he was 30.
There's something about that.
I'll just connect.